I'm Ulysses. Everyone in my life right now is insane. One day, these crazy adventures will get me into trouble I can't get out of. But life is about taking risks when it counts.
Maybe smoke a smidge less pot before bedtime?
I need to start by asking you, Gregg, where the hell did this idea come from?
Well, it's like I've been wanting to make a show like just a really groundbreaking, like crazy show like Now Apocalypse for years. I made a film called Nowhere back in 1996. And so there's, but I've been really interested in the TV space and the TV audience and the idea that when you make TV, you get to beam your sort of vision out to the whole world at once, versus my background is in sort of indie films where, you know, you make a film and gets released and gets on DVD, and you know, it really gets out there very slowly. So I've been wanting to do a show that's really kind of crazy and sexy and fun, like Now Apocalypse, for a while, and it kind of just all magically came together. I co-wrote the script with my BFF, Carly Shortino, who I don't know if anybody watches her show Slut Ever. She's a sort of a human.
Woo! Woo! Carly!
Welcome. She's sort of a human sexuality expert and writes a sex column for Vogue. And we're both very interested in sex and sexuality in terms of the way, not in a sort of lascivious or titillating way, but the idea that sex and sexuality is very formative in terms of your character and your identity. It really makes you the person that you are. So we wanted to do kind of a sex comedy a la, you know, Girls or Insecure or Sex and the City. But I kind of feel like you can't just do that show anymore because it's sort of been done so much. So there's this whole other layer to the show. It's sort of a very David Lynch, Twin Peaks, kind of mysterious, surreal part of the show that makes the universe of the show completely like wide open creatively. And we can kind of, as you can tell, I don't know if you've seen all 10 episodes, but it kind of goes to these insane places. And it really opens up the world of creatively where we can kind of do almost anything, and it's super, super exciting, and it was just a super fun show to make. And plus, I have the most amazing cast ever, so it was just a really fun ride for us.
Mm-hmm. Now, before I do throw to the cast, I just wanted to ask you, what has it been like working in television versus film?
I really loved it. I mean, I love the writing of the show, the arcs of the show over the 10 episodes, and building in the cliffhangers, and the sort of episodic structure of it. And also, for me, it was great to build these characters, and really, you live with these characters through 10 episodes versus just sort of a 90-minute movie, and you become really invested in them. That's one of the things that I was really struck, and again, it's a tribute to my great cast, that how emotional the show became for me. Like, you really invest in them and their journeys and what they go through, and the show has kind of a big payoff in the season finale, and so it's cool TV. You develop a different relationship with it. You sort of, these people become almost like your friends versus a movie where you just have this experience, and that's one of the reasons why I really wanted to do a TV show.
Now, for the cast, whoever wants to jump in first, what was your initial reaction? Don't jump in all at once. What was your initial reaction when you saw this script? Because I would imagine it was different than other projects that you had read before.
Yeah, I mean, that's, I think, the reason why you wanted to write it, the reason why we all liked it, is because, you know, there's so much television out there. There's like, you know, 500 new television shows a minute, it feels like. And they're like, oh, catch up on this one. And you can, like, no one has the amount of time it takes to watch all the TV shows that are being made. So something that really stands out in the marketplace becomes, like, way more important than, like, just making a show for the making of the show's sake. And so when I read the script, I was like, well, there's nothing like this on television that delves into real, like, sexual relationships with millennials that feel authentic, that feel not clinical, that feel just like really, like, again, like sexuality is such an important part of what forms who we are as people. So it's not just titillation. It's you know, it's exploring of humans, you know, and there's aliens in it and shit. So it's crazy. So that's weird and different. And yeah, and also just like, you know, it's a really, I think I got sent the first 10 episodes. I was like, I'm gonna read the pilot, I'm gonna go out and do some stuff, and then I'm gonna come back and read the rest of the show. And I canceled the stuff I had to do and read all 10 episodes. It's just like, it's so easy to watch, and it's so entertaining, and it's lots of fun. And you know, the show that we read is the show that we shot is the show that you watch. Like, it's like very little changing other than, you know, Greg's vision for it, I think. What about you guys?
Hey, you said it all, man.
Thanks, man.
You got it.
High five. There you go. Anything else?
A lot else, yes.
Come on.
Yes.
What else?
Now,
Roxane has something to add.
What do you want to say?
Oh my God, you want me to say something?
Yeah, go ahead.
No, I'm just kidding.
So,
say something.
I was a huge fan of Greg. He's one of my favorite American directors. And I had the chance to work with him on the movie Kaboom 10 years ago.
Woo.
So when he called me for the show, I said yes without reading the script.
Without even reading it. That's great. Yeah. Because he's good.
Would you say no now that you know what it was?
Don't ask that.
I changed my mind.
No comment.
Too late.
So on the surface, I think the show could seem eccentric, but there's obviously themes in there that resonate and are very universal. What would you say those themes are that can really hook in anyone and that anybody could relate to?
Well, we're good friends on the show.
Carly's like, I want to answer that one.
We're good friends on the show, you and I.
Yeah.
And that's nice. A good friendship, a good healthy friendships. I don't know. I think the show is just really does a really good job of showing just relationships that really feel familiar, you know, that don't feel... I think when people try to tackle like edgy relationships, it all comes a bit like contrite and like sort of fake and phony. Whereas this, you know, it feels like these
authentic,
are people.
Authentic, yeah.
Yeah, this is people trying to find love, you know. I think Ulysses, my character, is sort of like a sexual astronaut, you know. He's like exploring like what it is to be a human being and what it is to be with people, I think the relationships that he has in the show, the two loves he has in the show, are really like compelling and really good arcs. Like, they're really good, fun television, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anything else?
I mean, it's basically a coming of age story, like punk rock coming of age story, and they use sex and, you know, celebrity and whatnot to find who they are.
Yeah. And LA is crazy. I don't know if you realized, and it's such a character in the show, and it does such a good job of like explaining everyone's first 3 years out here. It's like, you know, for some reason you're in a Starbucks, and then you meet somebody who gives him your business card, and now you're at a party at like in the hills, and you've met someone, and you're like, what, are we flirting, I guess? Was that flirting? And then you wake up the next morning, and you're like, I think we were flirting, because there you are. And so, yeah, it does a good job of kind of like everyone, young people kind of like developing their self themselves in Los Angeles.
Yeah, I mean, LA, to me, is one reason why a lot of my films are set here. It's a very surreal, kind of hallucinogenic place, and I've always been really interested in that sort of intersection between fantasy and reality, where you don't really know what's real and what's not real. And so the show, you know, I really sat out to make my dream show, and I always knew it would be set in Los Angeles. And then I can also tell kind of some funny stories I've collected over the years in terms of things that have happened to me, parties I've been at, premieres, or, you know, characters you run into. So much of that kind of backstory stuff is woven into the show.
Well, I'm glad that you both brought up LA, because I was going to ask about it. The four of you, of course, are actors. Do you relate to any of what's going on in this show and kind of the growing pains of LA? Were you able to bring any of your own experiences?
I mean, Greg trolling us and saying that acting is, what was the word, exact words he used? A soulless, vampiric.
The amount of times that I talk about how like actors are like the worst people, like, why do we do this?
Why would you do that? It's so us trolling us, and then also like the second level like troll of having us having to say it in the show.
So playing that struggling actor, because Carly is having a not so great career. All of it's been there, based in reality, just kind of over it sometimes. It's wild. the business.
It's a wild ride.
Mm-hmm. Now, also, I believe all of you, but if I am wrong about this, I apologize. I believe all you are millennials. Is that correct?
I don't know when it begins and ends.
Technically?
Does anyone know begins and ends? Millennials?
I feel like I might be like 1 year off from it.
We're going to go
with
it.
A millennial?
Because this is
what knows? Is like...
I looked into this like recently, and I think I'm like 1 year off. I don't know what I am.
Okay.
Don't get us started. We'll just rant and rant and rant. You have to really control us.
I'm going to reel it back in.
Reel us in. Come on.
What I was going to ask is, this show obviously is about kind of your own generation and this age group, and it's not just being in LA and being an actor. Yes, that's what the story is, but people that are around this age group, they're dealing with dating apps, and they're dealing with finding their sexuality and exploring their sexuality. So how were you able to kind of bring your own experiences into that? Because you're playing the same age group that you are, and you have friends and peers that are also dealing with all of these things.
It's hard for us to hear, sorry.
Yeah. Oh, it's hard.
We can't, it's very strange because the sound is coming from over there.
Okay, so I was asking given that this is a show, thank you. We're double mic now. Thank you. So given that this is a show, a show about your own generation, are you able to bring your own experiences into it? Because what people in this generation are dealing with is dating apps and exploring your sexuality.
I think what's really, it's like you inevitably use your life experience, of course. But what's cool about acting is it makes you, it teaches you things, and it makes you explore in different ways. So Ford starts going on this kind of sexual odyssey, and it makes you question how you behave sexually. And it kind of opens up your horizons, and that's all I will say about that.
Hey!
did you learn some lessons? Well, is that it?
Yeah.
Why?
Did you ever discover the real version of the sex cult that's around? No, I don't know. I just to piggyback on what were saying, I think that, like, inevitably, you use yourself, and I think that dating apps are so weird. I've never been on one, and I had to learn a lot about how they work, you know, in order to, like, you know, sort of understand.
Avan doesn't need dating apps.
But isn't that like a need or not? I would say probably life would be much simpler if I was on dating apps.
They're really amazing, actually.
Really?
Yeah.
Fantastically simple.
I
what's your preferred app?
All in happy relationships.
No, you just, the amount of people you can meet, and you can, is the world has never seen this.
And so you can, like, just get rid of, you can it's working.
It's very efficient. It's very efficient.
Great, that's what they ask for when they true love. It's like, can I get efficiency with my true love? It'd be great. Roll them, I don't care.
Well, on the topic of dating apps and dating, the show obviously very much does not shy away from exploring your sexuality. And that's something that all of your characters have in common, is that you're exploring your sexuality and putting it front and center. So I wanted to know, both from Gregg, but also from the cast, why you think it's so important for this show to really highlight that, front and center, not shying away from any of those scenes.
I mean, for me, I've always had a lot of sex and kind of sexuality in my films. And one
hell yeah.
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 The quote from this. I've always had a lot of sex, period.
Sex.
That's why as a journalist, you can't, like, films. Punctuation's very important.
And the reason being is that as a director, I'm very interested in those intimate moments with the characters. As I said, it's not really from a lascivious or titillating point of view. It's more the idea, the example I give is that everybody has their sort of public persona or the person that they are when they're around their friends. But anybody that you've slept with knows you in a way that nobody else knows you. And as a director, that's where I'm super interested in that aspect of the character. So that's one of the things I think that's so powerful about the show, is that you really get to know these characters in the most intimate moments, and you really, really relate to them, and you really pull for them, or I find I really pull for them. And so you just become so invested in them, and that's what's most interesting to me, is not really just, the sort of surface of who these characters are, but really the nitty-gritty, and when they're really naked, like physically naked and emotionally naked, those are the moments that interest me, and that's why I was so excited about the show, and also so excited about this cast, because they really got that, and they really, you know, the sex scenes are never fun to shoot. They're kind of awkward and sort of a pain. They're not sexy at all. They're really just work. But everybody got that work and really invested, you know, brought all their talent to it and really brought those moments to such incredible life. I'm, again, so thrilled with this amazing group right here.
That's sweet.
Well, I also think for the two women on this panel that something that I really took away from watching it as a young woman myself is some viewers, not myself, might, I think maybe 5 years ago when storytelling on television and film wasn't as it is today, might be like, whoa, like look what's on screen. But really, if you look at it, this is two women who are empowered, who are owning their sexuality.
That's why I love that about this show. And all of, especially like with the female characters, we're very empowered by our sexuality and we're exploring it and we're not afraid of it. Nobody's tortured by their sexuality and it, you know, it's not all a dream sequence. It's like it shows the mishaps. We laugh. Things happen. Like, I love that part of it. It feels real. And to play a character that is so unapologetic, and she's a sex worker, and, you know, and she's empowered by it, and she applies that confidence to the rest of her life, to her relationship, to her job, takes kind of a hold of things, is awesome. I couldn't ask for anything more.
Mm-hmm. Roxane, did you also feel that way?
Well.
We.
I'm French. So sexuality, you know, it's not something
say it every
that
panel.
Crazy for.
Every panel you say French.
So no, it wasn't wow or whoa, my God, for me.
You're like, this is just every day. We're good.
This
We're
is
good
my here. First rodeo, okay?
Yeah. Now, Gregg, you directed all 10 episodes. What was that experience like? That's a huge undertaking.
Yeah, it was kind of, the show was really such a crazy adventure. I mean, we shot all 10 episodes in 40 days. So literally, in 2 months, the whole show was cross-border, and I directed all 10 episodes. And it was really super fun and super exciting. It was great for the cast because they got all 10 of their scripts advance, and they knew exactly what their arcs were going to be and where they were in terms of their arc. And so we just basically blasted the whole show out. And it was really great for the show, I think, because it has one vision and it has one sort of stylistic voice behind it. So it's very unified as a, you know, across the 10 episodes. But it was also super challenging, but one of the most exciting creative experiences I've ever had. It was amazing.
And to piggyback on that, like as an actor doing two months boarded 10 episodes with one single creative vision, there's so much like creation by committee in this industry. There's so much like top down, like people, you've served many masters, and to be able to throw your entire weight behind one creative person who you really trust, like an auteur who you actually trust and you ask to trust their vision, rather than like, hey, so you're on this show now, I'm show running it, but you'll see me like once every 3 weeks, and here's a new guy or a new girl every day, every week directing you. It was so nice to have solidarity, and you felt like really a part of the project as opposed to being like kind of a gun for hire.
It wouldn't have been the same.
No, I mean, there's no creative consistency. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's one of the, you know, any of the good shows, you have like, you know, Vince Gilligan, or you Breaking Bad, or any of these shows, like, so there's a creative vision behind it that's singular. And I love that about this show.
Mm-hmm. Now, on the topic of the creative vision, as you said, you co-wrote the series with Carly. Why was it important to have a female voice working with you on this show? So I'd love to hear your perspective on that, but also from Kelli and Roxane on why that was important for your character development to have a female writer on the show.
I really loved it. I mean, it was so, like, Carly's one, like, a really good friend of mine. We met on an indie film that she had written that I was attached to produce and direct. And I just met her, and we immediately hit it off. We're just very much kindred spirits. And she's so fun, and she's so funny and smart. And, you know, I think about, I could have written all 10 episodes myself, but the show would have been a completely different show. Like, having her voice and having the conversation with her, and we would sort of trade off scenes. Like, I'd write one scene, she'd write another scene, and, like, I'd rewrite this scene. You know, we just have, there was just more of a dialogue going on. And it was always very important to me. I've always been a very hardcore feminist. And, it was very important to me to have a female voice, and also the fact that she is this sort of sex bird, and she's done all this research for whatever, and these, you know, she's gone to like BDSM chambers and like sex parties and or like all this stuff. They're like, oh, and like in episode 8 we have this scene that has a sensual waterboarding in it. And she like, so there'd be this stuff that I'd be, what is the, you know, so it was great. It like opened up this whole other world that it just made the show to me so much more fun. And it was really one of my like favorite parts of doing the show.
Now for Kelli and Roxane, what did it add to your characters having a female writer on this show?
Well, it really helped them in so many ways.
Well, you too.
Things I learned because of Carly. Not to say that we have the same name, that it's not based on her a little bit, especially after reading her book. I'm like, I do all of these things on the show. Carly's amazing, and it was just, obviously, she's a sexpert, and... Carly's wonderful, and just to have that person behind us giving us a strong female voice and being able to actually do that was it really helped a lot with it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, what about you?
Well, Carly is amazing, but I have to say that Gregg always writes very strong female characters, so I don't know. I'm sorry.
Carly getting fired?
He doesn't have a vagina, but still, I mean.
He's also just a very talented guy, you know?
It's true. It's like, I remember when I said yes to Kaboom before reading the script, and then I read the script.
Pattern.
Like, I'm so this guy, you don't need, like, he's amazing.
Hard.
You just want to work with him.
Roxane's French, so it's hard for her to actually read a script. She's like, oh, I'll just do it, and then show up.
Yeah, I said yes before. And then I read the script, and I was like, oh, my God, I'm lucky because it's, like, an amazing character. And he always writes very strong, powerful female characters. Actually, in the show, women are smarter than guys.
They're more in control.
That's how my life has always been. The women are always the most in control and more powerful. It is, you know?
There is a scene between the two of you, Roxane and Beau. I think it's episode 1 where you're saying how much smarter she is than you. Is that episode 1 or episode 2? But that,
all of them, yeah.
All of them. But one specific scene that I was cracking up over.
Now, Roxane is a rocket scientist in the show. And
astrobiological theory.
Wow.
And which is actually based on a friend of mine. His wife is a total stunning, beautiful supermodel / rocket scientist. And Beau is an aspiring screenwriter.
Who am I based off of? Don't say his name.
Is he based off of someone?
Maybe.
Well, for the cast, do you know people in real life who are like your characters?
No.
No, I. You know what I love about this show is it lives in the fantastical. You know, there's a lot of, like I was sort of saying at the beginning, there's a lot of shows out there. There's a lot of, like, recording sort of like mundane, like sort of life. And for 22 minutes, like, it's just jam-packed with like fantasy and brightness and fun and...
28 minutes.
Sure, 28 minutes. Well, no, they vary, right? 28, 22 minutes. You know, it's spectacular. It's other, it's worth filming. And, you know, it doesn't mean that there's not reality between the relationships, but as far as like these people, they're amazing and fantastical. And that's why are we in this? Why would we ever want to make television shows or movies about anything other than that?
Yeah. Well, you mentioned kind of the... Thank you. You mentioned the kind of the style of the show, and I did want to ask Gregg about that. It's very kind of hyper-stylized when you look at it. It's bright and also really dark at some points. Can you just talk about kind of the creative vision that went into the actual look of the series?
Yeah, as I said, I've been making films, kind of hyper-stylized, crazy movies for about 25, 30 years. And for this show, I was so lucky. I got my DP, my production designer. Tracy's out there,
Tracy.
My costume designer.
Yeah.
I got all my usual suspects, all my collaborators to work with me. And I told them all, like, you know, the movies have been crazy, but I want to bump this show up to a whole other level. And so we sort of cranked it all to 11. And One of the reasons I did that was that I know as a DGA member and WGA and Academy, you get so many screeners, you know, and there's always like so many shows, like Avan was talking about, there's so many shows to watch. It's like, oh, you gotta watch this show, you gotta watch it, and just, everybody has a stack of shit to watch, you know, it's like you gotta catch up on all this stuff. And my goal with the show was to sort of get to the top of everybody's stack. Because it's like you always watch the thing that's a little bit fun and pop and sexy and colorful and has the most gorgeous cast on TV. And so the idea of the show being this pop fun thing was always in the back of my mind when we were shooting it, because it's like sometimes shows are like homework a little bit, like they're very important and serious and you gotta watch this show. It's like 12 hours of something really important. And so for this show, I think the show is really, I do think the show is important. I think it's really provocative, but it's super fun. And Roxane brought up the idea that the show's like candy, and that's the idea, is that you can just consume it like that. And that was sort of my reason why it looks the way it does. Mm-hmm.
The show also does a really wonderful job of putting queer relationships on the screen. And not a lot of other shows are doing that right now. What do you hope that, or do you hope, do you think of this, that you think Now Apocalypse can kind of help media and help other shows follow suit and show every sort of relationship and every sort of romance on screen?
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the things I'm most proud about the show is, like, in general, you know, we're one of the very few shows out there out of the 500 shows. Vita is another one, and it's also on Starz, that has a lead who's a queer person of color. And that was so important to me in terms of the show and the message. The idea that I know for my films, which also have queer themes, I've had people come up to me and, like, you know, Doom Generation or Nowhere or whatever, and, like, meant so much to me as a teenager. I felt so alone and I was so isolated. You know, I grew up in Kentucky or Dakota or some, or, you know, some faraway place. And, you know, that's, again, one of the things I was so excited about doing a TV show, because the idea that it just beams out there everywhere, like, all over the world. You know, like, a lot of people in Russia and, like, places where gay people are really oppressed and they're, you know, violently, you know, sort of violently held back. And the idea that the show could be out there and spread, you know, spread this positive message, a sort of love and hope, in times that are now, you know, sort of a little bit dark. It's a little bit of a oppressive time again, given the sort of political situation. That's one of the things I'm most proud of. And I think that the show, I can tell already from the sort of feedback on Twitter and internet stuff, is like it really means so much to especially young people who feel kind of isolated. And that's probably, I think, the biggest accomplishment of the show.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. Does anyone have anything else to add?
Beau does.
Do you have a question?
What time is Anthropology open to?